Welcome to Youth Mission Sunday. I'm Morgan.
And I'm Thomas.
And we hope that this service is a blessing to you all.
We're going to start out by reviewing some footage from last year's mission trip.
We hope that you guys pray for our safety on this trip.
And if you would like to help out in any way, watch to the end of the video for more information.
A youth works trip is hard to describe to those who haven't been. There's a certain stress that's felt going into it, knowing you're about to lose most of the decision-making over your life for a week. Then they're sleeping on the floor, surrounded by a dozen or more people, the uncertainty of where you'll be placed to serve for the week, and who you might serve with. No privacy, no alone time. You cook together as a team, clean together as a team, and it's not easy. But as the sun sets on your first day, something beautiful happens when you strip away most of the familiarity from your life. These trips focus on serving the communities we travel to, opening our eyes to the challenges of an unfamiliar place and also the people and organizations working to solve these challenges. But it goes much deeper. We learn how to live in community. We learn to listen a little closer, to serve one another. We worship together and laugh together. There's morning devotions and storytelling and a time to debrief each night. We watch for and share the ways God has been present in our day. And for a short period, you begin to forget about the regular, mundane life back at home and embrace a new norm of daily service. Thursday night lands, you feel like you just arrived, but it also feels like you've always been here. And then we're reminded of Jesus' example of servanthood for us in the Gospels through foot washing. And so, leaders are privileged to wash the feet of these students. Leaders pray for them, speak truth over their lives, and bless them in anticipation of them returning home to the things God already has planned for their lives. The word that best describes our students at the end of the week is eager. Eager to find ways back home to serve their communities and keep the momentum going. You see, it goes without saying these trips are grounded in God's word and showing love to an unfamiliar community. But the unexpected is that God uses these trips in astonishing and unexpected ways to grow the hearts of all the students and adults in ways that pay dividends for years to come.
Our reading from today comes from Ephesians 3:14 through 21. For this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your heart through faith, and I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and how long and high and deep is the love of Christ. And to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to measure all of the fulfillments of God. Now, to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Jesus Christ throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
South acting as that buffer zone. You can see this arc in the clouds here indicating that ridge. And remember, high means dry, so that's what that's doing for us, leaving us with clear skies, dry conditions, and warmer high temperatures. Then that next wet and cool system dropping south from the Gulf of Alaska towards the Pacific Northwest is what brings that change of pace on tap for the weekend. So today, sunshine at 8 a.m. It's going to be a bright one out there. The sunglasses is a great idea. Noon, same story. And 5 p.m., same story. with temperatures that are very comfortable later on today. Midday, we're starting to see most showers working into our higher elevations with scattered showers after that on Saturday. And then we'll see a little bit of a lull late Saturday night and early Sunday for another wave of heavier rainfall moving later Sunday. A little lull on Monday and then more showers on Tuesday. 50s to lower 60s in the foothills, and if you're in the valley, it's mid to upper 60s, flirting with 70s in some areas this afternoon, with plenty of sunshine on tap, so take advantage. Today looks fantastic. Lighter showers Monday and then heavier rain on Tuesday before we dry out, clear out, and warm up from the middle to latter half of next week.
If you're happy with your current bakery bread, you're lying to yourself. Our bakers are rooted in the truth that truly good bread doesn't need fillers or additives, just simple, honest ingredients. Honest ingredients, honestly good, honest harvest.
Hey man, how's it been?
Pretty good. How about you?
I'm doing all right. I've been a little tired lately.
Yeah, I feel that.
How's work been going?
Pretty good, but I had this weird customer that before they left, they wrote me this note that said, "You missed a spot, do better." And after they had left and I had cleaned, when I came back to that table, there was a spot that I missed. And I was like, well, how do they know that? Kind of weird, kind of freaked me out, you know?
That's kind of weird. I wouldn't let it bother you that much, though. Anyways, who do you think will be at the party tonight?
I don't know, probably most of school. It's this new rich guy that moved in, so we'll have to see who comes.
Maybe he'll hook me up with some of that dough.
We'll see about that.
You guys ready for this party?
Yeah.
You guys excited? You think Slug's gonna be here?
Probably not.
Oh, thank you, thank you. Let's go.
Oh, no soliciting, guys.
Well, hello, friends.
What's going on here for the party?
This is Pepper, yes.
Oh, what's up, Pepper?
Welcome.
Bro, it's about to be insane.
Open it up.
Well, hey, howdy, hey. Welcome to
hello.
The party.
Woo!
Come in.
You think this party's gonna be good?
Yeah, I think it'll be pretty good. You think that guy will be there you talked about?
Probably the guy with all the money.
Yeah, I hope he's there.
Yeah, I hope
he's there. $100. I think he'll impress someone.
Hello?
Hey, what's up, nerds? Welcome to the party.
Thank you.
Come on
That's
in.
Smart.
I hate her, bro. She's horrible. Oh my gosh, you know who I hate? Dylan. Like, he's always late. Is he even gonna show up?
I hope he doesn't.
I hope he doesn't either. I mean, I can't stand the kid. One, he's all weird and emo, okay? He's like some quiet kid, okay? And two, he dresses like some Portland hipster. I mean, I don't get it. Like, why is Dylan so weird?
I know, but we're just talking about. And she said this
exact
thing on the
note. Okay.
So she was at the pizza place.
I love that.
But I'm telling you, it's her.
Do you?
Hey, you, drop something.
My name is Dylan, and this will be my third mission trip. It was the fall of my fifth grade year. The first semester was ending. I felt like I was doing well with my grades. I was focused, and I was enjoying my classes. I had made some new friends, and finally became part of the popular group. I felt like I had arrived socially. It was the group that everyone wanted to be in, and it felt good. I got invited to my first ever sleepover birthday party. It's a big deal. We arrived, and they had a literal mansion. There was a full-size basketball court and an in-ground pool. It was incredible. I couldn't believe that I was part of this group, that they had actually welcomed me. But I didn't know at the time that being friends with these people was going to cost me something. I didn't realize that being part of this group would mean I would need to look down at other students. To stay in the group, I would need to belittle kids who they saw as poor. I started sticking up for some of the boys my new friends were making fun of, and the group started mocking me. They determined in their minds that I was gay, and their focus was now directed at me. This was the moment where my view of myself changed. Even though these friendships had ended, I took their hurtful messages with me and continue to repeat them to myself. You're not good enough. No one wants you. You'll never be accepted. You're different, which makes you wrong. Because of this, I started doubting God's love for me and his messages about me. If people think this about me, if I think this about me, how can what God thinks about me be true? Because of these incorrect thoughts, I lost touch with God. I forgot how he's always there and willing to help, just a prayer away. I started to build walls to keep people out, including my family. My focus was on my own failings, not on loving others. I didn't let people get close to me, so it was hard for me to receive love, but also to give love. I forgot how God saw me, and instead focused on how the world saw me. After setting God aside and taking up the world instead, I spiraled downward. I began to struggle with self-destructive thoughts and wondered maybe if I wasn't worth being loved. Through therapy, I started to learn how to communicate, to express what I needed and what other people could give me to help. And I started to grow. I realized that God had given me people to help and to lean on. I came back to God and started to renew my relationship with him. I started seeing him more in the people around me and feeling his love for me. I don't think I could have done this without my faith community and my family. I wish I could say after all that my problems were all fixed and I continued to do great. But unfortunately, that's not the case. Whatever you're telling yourself doesn't just immediately go away. We all need daily reminders about what God says in order to be able to make a change, to embrace his love for us, and then be able to share that love with other people. So, what lie are you believing about yourself?
Our reading for today is Paul's prayers for the church. This is a really short passage, but it covers a lot of ground, so much so that we're going to narrow the scope and focus on just a couple of verses from the reading. So I want to revisit verses 17 through 19. This is what Paul writes. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have the power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. And to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. So Paul is praying that we be rooted and established in love, have the power to grasp the love of Christ, know a love that surpasses all knowledge, and be completely filled with the fullness of God. This is a beautiful prayer for us, and it's a beautiful prayer for God's church. But let's be honest, a lot of times our lives are not a reflection of this prayer. We can know things without really knowing things. It's easy to acknowledge and say, yes, God loves me, but it's much harder to start to live out of that love, to make choices that show that we are firmly planted in God's care. Saying yes to God's love means saying no to a lot of other things. People-pleasing, perfectionistic tendencies, finding our value in success or accomplishments. If we were truly to embrace God's love, it might mean embracing failure or deciding to stop chasing after the love of people that don't actually care about us. It would mean removing whatever armor we've put on to protect ourselves from feeling hurt by others. And saying yes to God's love requires us to confront the untrue things we tell ourselves about ourselves and to replace them with his truth. You see, we've all got these messages we tell ourselves about ourselves, and then we make choices out of these lies. The lie that you're unlovable, you're unwanted, you don't belong, you're not enough. And then we live out of these lies instead of living out of the love of God. We hurt ourselves, but but we also hurt the humans around us. Our relationships and interactions become the place where we try to find the love and validation that only God can offer. We become enablers, controllers, and entertainers. It might look different for each of us, but it's really all the same. Some of us shut down and try to shut other people's out. But really, all of us are just hustling for our worth and hoping that the humans around us can love us strong enough and loud enough to drown out the lies we tell ourselves about ourselves. I remember a DCE video call I was once on, and the speaker shared something that I will never forget. He said that when someone says something about us and we find ourselves having, you know, a strong, guttural, emotional response to it, it's not actually the person's comment that's the issue. The issue is that the person's comment is simply a confirmation of what we've already said about ourselves to ourselves. See, I knew it. I am fill in the blank with whatever negative comment you choose. Only by shedding the illusions we craft about ourselves can we truly welcome the boundless love of God into our lives. To grasp God's love, we must let go of the lies. But how do we do that? Where do we start? Well, we start with Scripture. We go to God's Word. It's where we see the truth about Him and what He says about us as His children and His immense love for us. Then we spot the lies. Anything that doesn't match God's Word that we're telling ourselves about ourselves isn't true. It might feel true, but it isn't. So if it doesn't match up with what God says about you, then it's a lie. And then from there, we keep it on replay. It's not enough to just one time acknowledge the lies. We need to daily repeat and recall the truth of God's love so that it starts filling our hearts and our minds. I mean, that's one of the reasons why we gather as a church. We're here to get the much needed reminder about who God is, who we are, and who we are to Him. So, what reminder do you need today about God's love? Maybe you need the reminder that it is wider than any separation sin can cause. Maybe you're telling yourself the lie that your past is not forgiven, that your mistakes cannot be forgiven by Jesus, that He is still holding on to them. Maybe the reminder you need is that God's love is longer than any difficult situation you're in. The reminder might be that God's love is higher than any obstacle you are facing. Or maybe the reminder about God's love you need today is that it is deeper than any of the flawed ways of thinking you have about yourself.
Hi, I'm Morgan King, and this will be my third mission trip. There's just nothing close to a mission trip. Unless you've been on one, it's hard to understand. You're with people all the time, every minute of every day, and you grow and learn about others and yourself through service, self-reflection, group talks, and group experiences. My first mission trip was truly one of a kind. I'd never been that far away from home for that long, and never with this group of people. The trip was amazing, and I had a really awesome time. It included going on swan boats, Red Rocks Amphitheater, Phil playing the WWE theme song on the recorder he had brought for dinner, and going around in a lion costume in the school we stayed at in Pocatello, Idaho. My second mission trip was very different, since it was a new group of people, and I wouldn't have my older brother there to comfort me. Not to mention, this trip was much farther than Colorado, being in Savannah, Georgia. Still, this trip did grow me and was more fun than I had expected. Highlights of this would be eating a foot-long hot dog at Disney World, Craig, the cockroach, Riley, and June trying to smuggle three different pillows home on the airplane. But what was unseen was the challenges and lies I was telling myself throughout this trip. Nobody likes you. You're trying too hard. Try harder. You don't fit in. If I'm not liked, am I loved? Does God love me? Am I really rooted in God's love on this trip? Am I really rooted in God's love on this trip? This question probably would have stumped me a year ago. Although I've only gone on two trips, I feel like I have learned and gained a lot of knowledge and wisdom of the depths and extent to which God loves me. He's reminded me I am more capable than I know I am. Being rooted in his love can be uncomfortable and feel very exposing. I can say that being on a mission trip is a very vulnerable experience, and other people on the trip will see every side of you. You're conquering and pushing yourself to do a variety of tasks and learning and practicing the love of God. To me, being rooted in his love is uncomfortable. It makes me more dependent on him and less independent. It pushes me out of my comfort zone, like speaking in front of a room of people about a cockroach when I've had no time to prepare. It blesses me with the motivation to try to discover his word, his extension of love, and his promise to me that he loves me more than I can ever think, no matter my wrongdoing. When you're on a mission trip, being rooted is something you do every day, and it works. The burdens are lifted, connections grow, and who I am as a person feels more authentic. Embracing God's love has also helped me to be more patient, compassionate, and considerate of others. The connections I made helped me conquer negative thoughts and feelings I've had about myself my entire life. Priorities start to change, weaknesses weaken, and the thought and knowledge of being seen and heard by him triumphs. To start to think of the idea of letting just little negative comments be the defining factor of who I am starts to seem absurd. Knowing God's love for me makes sense, and I have felt tremendous growth in who I am and who I want to be from the experience of the mission trips. So I challenge you. The next time a negative thought or comment pops into your head because of what you think of yourself or what someone else has said to you, remember that being rooted in the love of God can be the difference between being a branch or a tree trunk. The trunk won't be cut down through the watering and care of Jesus. But if you are a branch, the strength of just the wind can be enough to knock you down. We each get to choose between being a tree trunk or a branch. Stay rooted. Amen.